Welcome to Smart News Digital. The topics that we are going to discuss today, the 26th of September 2018, are the following eight. Let's discuss them in detail. The first topic for the day is Supreme Court asks Parliament to frame laws to bar those who are accused of crimes from fighting elections. This article deals with the issue of Supreme Court asking the political parties to publish online the pending criminal cases of the candidates. Now, this direction of the Supreme Court has been made on the back of a batch of petitions to bar politicians who are facing charges of heinous crimes from contesting elections. The court has stated that the parliament must frame strong laws to make it obligatory for the political parties to remove leaders who are charged with heinous crimes like rape, murder, kidnapping, and they also must refuse ticket to these offenders in both parliamentary and assembly polls. The five-judge bench has also stated that the court cannot legislate on behalf of the parliament and hence the parliament must make strong laws in this regard. So what are the steps that needs to be taken by the political parties according to the Supreme Court? The first one is the candidates should state their criminal past to the election commission in block letters. And the second one is the candidates should make full disclosure of their criminal cases pending against them to the political parties on whose ticket they are going to stand. And the third one is the parties in turn must put the complete details of the candidates on their websites for public use. And the next one is both the candidates and political parties must declare the criminal antecedents of the candidates in newspapers, television, not once but thrice after filing the nomination papers. In this case, Chief Justice of India, Mr. Deepak Mishra, explained that these directions to the political parties is a step towards fostering and nurturing an informed citizenry. It is also to protect the culture and purity in politics. The CJA further added that criminals in power are nothing but a liability in this country and their presence strikes at the root of democracy in our country. He further stated that criminalization of politics strikes as a national and economic terror in India. In this case, the court has also observed that the Election Commission of India's hands are tied and they are helplessly watching as criminalization of politics at the entry level is rising day by day and year by year. And the court has concluded that it is high time for the parliament to enact strong laws in this regard to stop the criminalization of politics in our country. The next article for the day is lawyers elected as lawmakers can practice in courts, says the Supreme Court. This observation was made by Supreme Court in the writ petition filed by advocate Ashwini Kumar Upadhyay, who has argued that the legislature's doubling up as lawyers is a matter of serious concern to the judiciary of India. The court has stated that lawyers practicing before the Supreme Court and high courts will not be an issue of conflict of interest in this case. The court dismissed the argument in the petition that legal practice by lawmakers was in violation of Rule 49 of the Bar Council of India Act. Now, what this Rule 49 of the BCI Act states? It forbids an advocate to be full-time salaried employee of any person, government, firm, corporation, or any concern so as he continues to practice as a lawyer. Mr. Upadhyay had argued in the court that lawmakers drew salaries and pensions from the public exchequer and hence can be classified as employees. The court stated that the lawmakers cannot be called as full-time salaried employees of the state as they hold unique position in our democracy. Now, what is the argument put forth by the court to state that the legislators are not salaried employees? The court had stated that just because the legislators receive payment from the government in the name of salary will not result in the creation of a relationship of employer and employee between the government and the legislators. The court further added that though the legislators are deemed to be public servants, their status is certainly not one of a full-time salaried employee of the government. Further, the fact that disciplinary or privilege action can be initiated against them by the speaker will not also make them as a full-time employee of the government. The third article for the day is Voters' Choice on Maldives presidential polls. In this article, we are going to see about the interim results of the presidential election in Maldives, which has given the opposition candidate Ibrahim Sodhi a resounding victory against the present president Abdullah Yamin. About 58% of the Maldivian voters have selected Mr. Soli, Now, this is a time for rejoice in Maldives, regardless of the political affiliation. This is because the pre-election cynicism about the integrity of the electoral process has been disproved by the turnout of 89.2%. Now, this election result has come at the back of challenging time for Maldives. Now, what made this challenging time? The first one is the opposition had suffered a setback when former president Mr. Nasheed was arrested and disqualified from contesting in elections on charges of terrorism conviction. Another former president, Mr. Kayyum, was arrested and put behind the bars for an attempted coup. And the third one is there were many misgivings over the conduct of the elections by the Election Commission and the court and security forces. And also, the headquarters of Maldivian Democratic Party, which is the main opposition party, was raided. The next one is the counting procedures for the election were changed at the last minute, which led to confusions. And the last one is many foreign journalists, including from India, were denied visas, which questioned the integrity of the election process. In spite of all these challenging times, the election result had contrasted the worst fears about the elections. This election result in Maldives presents an important opportunity for India to revisit its ties with Maldives, which has went on a downward spiral in past few years. This is because the former president Yamin was perceived to be close to China, which the Maldives is so much indebted to now. Earlier in this year, Yamin had declared a state of emergency to which India had criticized. And in retaliation, Yamin had clamped down on visas to Indian job seekers. Now, with the change of government in Maldives, these Indian job seekers await some positive moves from the opposition. Also, India can renew talks about the fate of ICG, that is the Indian Coast Guard, and Air Force personnel stationed in Maldives, whose visas had been pending since June this year. The Indian government was quick to welcome the provisional results and congratulate Maldivian Democratic Party, to which Mr. Soli belongs. Going forward, New Delhi must take clear of the partisan positioning of the internal politics of Maldives, which will be on lines of the Panchsheel of India. And also, India must be partner to Maldives in its stability and development and should not see Maldives as a battlefield for great power ambitions between India and China. The fourth article for the day is a change in Maldives, which is the continuation of what we have seen in the previous article. At a time when President Yamin's second term was a done deal, the people of Maldives have voted for change and brought Mr. Ibrahim Soli as their president. Mr. Soli is a senior politician in the Maldives and was the joint presidential candidate of the opposition alliance containing the Maldivian Democratic Party, the Jamhuri Party and the Adalat Party. Now, the victory underscores the commitment of the Maldivian people for securing the future of democracy in their country. This is also stated by former President Nasheed in his tweet when he stated that Mr. Soli had done an extremely good service to the people. Now, this election was seen as a do-or-die battle for the Democrats in Maldives, and rightly they have succeeded. As you have seen, Prime Minister Modi congratulating Mr. Soli for his resounding victory in the elections. Also, the US Department had stated that the Maldivian people had raised their democratic voices to determine the future of their country. Now, this election results have come at troubled times for Maldives. For example, the Maldivian former president Nasheed was ousted in 2012 and Yamin had won a controversial election in 2013. Mr. Yamin's presidency had also seen Maldives drifting towards Islamic radicalism. And also, in February this year, Yamin had imposed 45-day state emergency, fearing an attempt to ouster him. And the last one being police high-handedness against the opposition like MDP. Yamin presidency in Maldives had seen closer ties with China and Saudi Arabia, which was against interest of India. Mr. Yamin had signed about 12 pacts last year with China, and he also endorsed China's ambitious Maritime Silk Road Initiative, which is part of BRI. And also during Yamin's presidency, Maldives became the second South Asian nation to sign an FTA with China after Pakistan. The opposition accused the Yamin government to colluding with China in the name of infrastructural development, which had led to land grab by Chinese. And they further added that the massive infrastructure growth funded by the Chinese had already put the Maldivian government into debt trap. Though the opposition had won the elections, the governance in Maldives will be tested as the democratic institutions have been fragile since the Yameen government. In this regard, we have seen that the change of government in Maldives has helped New Delhi in resetting its ties with Maldives. And also, we should remember that the political elites in India's neighbors would change, but if we act in the interests of the people of those neighbors, we can have a sustainable relationship with our neighbors. The next article for the day is Editing Our Genes. In this article, we'll be dealing with the issue of bioethicist fear about the abuse of gene editing technology. The American biochemist Jennifer Doudna, in her book, had stated about the incredible power of the technology of gene editing. The technology that she had talked about is CRISPR-Cas9 system. CRISPR stands for Clustered Regularly Interspaced Short Palindromic Repeats, which harnesses, that is, uses the natural defense of bacteria to alter the organism's genetic code. With this technology of CRISPR-Cas9, the DNA in any part can be cut and can be pasted elsewhere. So the technology uses Cas9 enzyme for cutting the DNAs. In 2017, American biologist Mitali Pau had used this CRISPR-Cas9 technology to repair a genetic mutation that could cause serious heart ailment. In this research, Mr. Mitali Pau had done on embryos in such a way that the faulty gene would not be passed on to the future generations. Now the question is, can accuracy be guaranteed in early embryonic stages? Now, since the CRISPR-Cas9 technology and gene editing methods are in its early stage, further research is needed to understand the positives and negatives of the gene editing technology. The present studies have shown that the edited cells using CRISPR-Cas9 technology can lack cancer-suppressing proteins. Now, the fear of the bioethicists is that this gene editing technology may be misused by the government and also the private players who might design designer babies on the request of the parents. And hence, this gene editing technology must be used carefully, taking into consideration the ethical implications in it. The sixth article for the day deals with Supreme Court harks back to Mumbai blast to cite criminalization. In this issue, the Supreme Court, the Constitution Bench, has stated that political patrons had nexus with criminal gangs, police and custom officials. It stated the case of 1993 Mumbai blast, in which the criminalization of politics had been felt strongly. The Supreme Court had also mentioned the NN Ora committee, which had been set up after the 1993 blast, to study the problem of criminalization of politics and the nexus among criminals, politicians and bureaucrats in India. This committee had stated in its report that the criminals network was virtually running a parallel government. The committee also mentioned that money power was first acquired through real estate, and this power was used to build nexus with the politicians. And also, the money power is used to develop network of muscle power, which is used by the politicians during the elections. The court had observed that the 18th report of the parliamentary committee to the Rajya Sabha had also mentioned about the criminalization of politics. In this report, it had stated that the feeling that politics should be cleansed of persons with established criminal backgrounds is a felt need. The court has also observed about the Law Commission report of 244. In this report, the Law Commission had stated that earlier politicians were having nexus with the criminals, but in the later part, the criminals themselves had entered into politics, which has corrupted the political system in India. For this, the Law Commission had stated an empirical data which states that in the 10 years from 2004 to 2014, 18% of candidates contesting in elections in national or state elections had criminal cases against them. This observation of the Law Commission was vindicated by Goswami Committee on Electoral Reforms in 1919 that highlighted the crippling effect of money and muscle power in politics in India. The next article for the day is Need for an Employment Policy to Solve Jobless Growth, which is stated by the State of Working India 2018 study, released by the Azim Premji University Center for Sustainable Employment. This study observed that higher growth rates in India had not transformed into creation of employment opportunities, and also higher productivity has not resulted in employment creation. And hence, there is need for Indian government to formulate national employment policy. This study of State of Working India 2018 used the government data to show that total employment had actually shrunk between 2013 and 2015 by 7 million. It further stated that the unemployment rate had risen more than 5% overall, and it has been increasing in the northern states more than in any other part of India. And it has also stated that young people with higher education levels suffer from unemployment of more than 16%. While the wages in most sectors had been improving, the rural wage growth has collapsed since 2014, noted the study. The report had stated that in the organized manufacturing sector, the number of jobs have been increasing, and so does the contract works, which is characterized by lower wages and also less job security. The cause for concern in this sector is the divergence of productivity and wages. That is, even though the productivity has increased, the wages have not commensurately increased. This can be seen in the empirical data that the labor productivity in this sector has increased by 6 times in the last 30 years. And in the same period, the supervisorial and managerial salaries have increased only by 3 times. And further, the workers' wages have increased only by 1.5 times. This shows the divergence between the productivity and wage growth. Another important concern stated in the report is, and the women participation across the states are also differing. For example, in Uttar Pradesh, only 20 women are in paid employment, whereas in Tamil Nadu, it is 50, and in Mizoram and Nagaland, it is about 70. One of the serious concerns stated in the study is the caste gap is actually greater than the gender gap. That is, the Dalits and the lower castes are overrepresented in low-paying jobs, and they are very, very underrepresented in the high-paying jobs. And also the data shows that the lower castes earn only 50 to 56% of what the upper castes earn. Hence, this study shows that the Indian government needs to take a national employment policy which will lead to improvement in employment generation and equitable distribution of resources. The last article for the day is, India ranks 158th in human capital score behind Sudan. This study, which is conducted by Institute for Health Metrics and Evaluation, has stated that India ranks 158th on its investment on healthcare and education. This study underscores the correlation between a nation's human capital score and its economic growth. India is placed behind Sudan, which is ranked 157th, and ahead of Namibia. This report states that the South Asian neighbors like Sri Lanka, Nepal, Bhutan, and Maldives are ranked higher than India. The report had stated that India is falling behind in terms of its investment in health and education of its citizens. It is important to note that India spends less than 2% of its GDP on education and health respectively, and this could have serious negative effects on the growth of Indian economy since it cannot reap the benefits out of demographic dividend. This study is based on the analysis of data from government sources like schools and healthcare systems. And this study has also stated that the greatest increase among sub-Saharan countries was in Equatorial Guinea with respect to the rank.